He who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with his own hands, that he may have something to share with those in need. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only that which is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. Do you realize how comprehensive the Christian gospel is? We're told you're not allowed to lie. We're told that you mustn't steal. We're told that you must work hard and be useful to other human beings with your hands. We're told that you must control your anger, that you must forgive. We're told that you have to be very, very generous with your money. We're told that you've got to take care of the poor. All these things. And you say, yeah, all religions say that. But don't forget, this is not a rule book as much as it is a gardening guide. It's not just saying that you, by your effort, can put together a life like this. It's talking about the fact that you can fertilize and cultivate your life in such a way that these things actually grow. Remember, the controlling verse is verse 24. Put on the new self. All the things that Paul's talking about here are not just something that you decide to do. The Christian life is not less than obeying the law. It's infinitely more. It's saying, if you think hard enough, and if you let yourself operate out of a knowledge of who you really are in Christ, this is the life that will result. That's very different than just simply saying, here, do all these things. In other words, if it's true that you're guaranteed a heavenly inheritance, if it's true that you're going to rule and reign with Jesus Christ forever as kings and priests, if it's true that Jesus Christ every day as your high priest stands before the Father and your name is engraved over his heart, if it's true that whenever God looks at you in Jesus Christ, he sees an absolute beauty, if it's actually true that Jesus Christ at the cost of his own life died for you, that we have a God then who is a God of truth, you shouldn't lie. A God who is gracious with his wealth, you should give. A God who is love, you should be forgiving. A God who is merciful, you should control your anger. You see, all it's saying is, this is the lifestyle of somebody who thinks about and thinks through who they are and takes God seriously. How you do it? You put on the new self. It's being consistent with who you are. It's putting on the new self. The most important thing about these two verses is that Paul is talking to Christians. When he says, do not steal, stop the stealing, we have to remember this is a letter to Christians. What does that mean? 1 Corinthians 6, it says, do you not know that people who are into sexual deviation, people who are abusive, people who are thieves, people who are blackmailers and extortioners, people who are greedy, these people will not inherit the kingdom of God. Now what that means is, on the one hand, a person, though they say they're a Christian, if they're not able to stop, if they're not able over a period of time to see progress, if they stay inveterate liars, if they stay locked in abusive behavior, if they stay caught in patterns of theft, they can say they're a Christian all they want, but they're not. Now, the Bible teaches that. The Bible says that you cannot continue, no matter what you say about, I came forward, I signed a card, I did this or that. If you are continually caught in those patterns and there's no progress, and you, in a sense, continually give yourself to them over a long period of time, you can just forget about making the claim, of course I'm a Christian because I made a prayer, or I said something, or I believe this or that. On the other hand, I think it's amazing that Paul, writing to Christians, assumes that there's people out there who are stealing. What that tells us is that Paul knows and understands that Christians do sin, and they do sin in pretty spectacular ways, and they do fall down. First of all, if you find that surprising, that proves that you really still do not understand the biblical doctrine of the new birth. See, the world will not let you get away with it. The world will say, if you're born again, you better be perfect. The world says that because the world cannot understand the gospel at all. The world understands that the only way to achieve heaven or achieve acceptance or to achieve righteousness with God, the only way to do that is to perform, is to obey the rules. The Bible tells us that our first ancestors, Adam and Eve, were born into a covenant of works. That means God put them into the garden and said, if you want life, you must obey me perfectly. If you want death, you disobey me. That was called the covenant of works. It was an agreement. Obey, you live. Disobey, you die. And of course, Adam and Eve died. They disobeyed. And God comes along with a new covenant in Christ. And you see, whereas Adam was our representative in the old covenant and he failed, and we all inherit our sin and guilt from Adam, in the new covenant we have a second Adam, Jesus Christ, who also came and was also given the law to obey, and he obeyed perfectly. He loved the Lord his God with all his heart, soul, strength, and mind, and he loved his neighbor as himself. And you see, the second Adam also was confronted with the law, and he obeyed the law. In the covenant of grace now, if you unite with Jesus Christ by faith, what happens? All of his righteousness becomes yours. How are you right with God? And the answer is, only by faith in Christ. Even though my conscience accuses me of having grievously sinned against all God's commandments, and having never kept any of them, nevertheless, without my deserving it at all, out of sheer grace, God grants and credits to me the perfect satisfaction, righteousness, and holiness of Christ, as if I had never sinned or been a sinner, as if I had been as perfectly obedient as Christ was obedient for me. All I need to do is accept this gift of God with a believing heart. Now listen, the world cannot figure that out. The world doesn't understand it. The word world in many cases hasn't even heard of it. And therefore, when they hear you say, I'm a Christian, I'm going to heaven, when they hear someone say, I'm born again, they have to stick that into their grid, you understand? And their grid is a grid of works righteousness. Their grid is a grid of performance. And so when they hear somebody say, I'm born again, I know I'm going to heaven, they look at you and they say, well, then you must be perfect. The audacity of someone to say they're going to heaven. They refuse, or they can't understand. Their minds are darkened. They can't understand it. So when you say, you're born again, they stick it into the grid and they say, therefore, everything's fine. The Bible says, See, when the Bible says all things are new, it does not mean, therefore, that everything from the old life has passed away. Oh, no. Paul says, hey, you know, I've got an old self and I've got a new self. Put off the old self, put on the new self. That's what this whole book's about. The newness is twofold. First of all, there's a legal newness. The moment that you unite with your second Adam by faith, the moment you say, I cannot fulfill the law, but my first Adam, my covenant head, my representative, Jesus Christ has fulfilled it all for me. And I unite with him by faith and I trust in him and I transfer and rest my trust in him instead of in my own performance. At that moment, what's all become new? You are legally, you are forensically perfect in God's sight. The Bible says your sins are wiped out and he sees you as an absolute beauty. But in actuality, what's happened, when you're born again, instead of your sinful habits going away, the taproot between them and your identity is cut. Paul says in Romans 7, sometimes in my inmost self, he says, I want to do the right thing, the law of God. But I find in myself another principle making war against the law of my mind. You know what he's talking about? Before you're a Christian, you look at your sin and you say, this is for me. You've got a conscience. You might say the law of God is in your conscience. It, every so often, makes you feel guilty. But your real me, your real self, your real I, your real identity is found in the life and self-glory. On the other hand, when you become a Christian, instead of all those habits going away, what happens is psychologically you change. In a sense, your ego, your I shifts. You no longer identify with that old life. You identify with the new life in Christ. And you find if you fall back into the old habit patterns that they don't satisfy anymore. You're still doing them, but they don't satisfy. You say, this isn't me. It used to be me. Before I was a Christian, I used to do this, and this is what I want now. I still do it sometimes, but it's not me anymore. I don't want it. You've really become new, but it doesn't mean that it's all the bad habits are gone. There's a sense in which Jesus Christ has taken over headquarters, but there's a lot of guerrilla warfare to be done out there in the hinterland, out in the suburbs. Jesus Christ has taken over City Hall, but the suburbs are full of the old things, and we've got to wipe them out. That's why Paul says, take off the old self, put on the new self. You're a Christian, you are capable of fairly deep sin. You're capable of falling a long way. David killed Uriah so he could commit adultery with Bathsheba. He was a believer. Christians steal. You may be stealing. You may be doing something like that right now. Don't doubt whether you're a believer. Just begin to get realistic about the fact that a Christian can fall down. Be realistic about what it means to say that I'm born again. Get realistic and serious about the fact that sin remains in your life and you've got real live guerrilla warfare to do out there.